And I know I want to let Naya jump in here because there's a lot there to unpack. And I know that you want to jump in and get on that. So let me allow you the opportunity to do that.
Thank you. If I had a handheld mic, I'd drop it because he really said everything. He said everything, and I'm sitting here getting excited because that's something I'm so passionate about. I mean, there are multiple facets of what you said that I'm passionate about expressing to the next generation, but the biggest one is that you, I think that when you come from less or when you come from poverty, when you come from, you know, a low-income household, you think that you're not primed for careers like the ones that we're currently doing, but I just think there's such an edge that comes with growing up like that. Reason being is because if you compare yourself and somebody that grew up with privilege, if their bike broke down, they got another one. If your bike broke down, you had to fix it. And what comes with that is problem solving, ingenuity, and those are the cornerstones of progress and innovation. And I'm just really excited for what you're doing because you are merging the challenge and the opportunity. Mm-hmm. You have children that are growing up with challenges, but that are getting some very unique and incredible perspectives, and you're giving them the opportunity to work with that. And I believe that there's just such magic in that in general. And then as far as just the interdisciplinary thing, as a space industry professional, I also come across people who think that space is just for scientists and engineers, and that couldn't be further from the truth. Because if we are looking to become an interstellar species, do you think scientists and engineers can make your laws? Can they, I don't know, pave your roads, you know? So it requires everyone, and so there's a place for everyone in space, so I want to make sure that's communicated. But I love everything that you're doing. I'm excited. I think that that's really going to be some world-changing initiatives.
And it's not just in space. We're talking, so just to use some of the language, I'm sure you all watched a hearing that took place on Capitol Hill the other day. So we're moving from an understanding and conversations around known unknowns to what they call unknown unknowns. And so what that means is that we're, you know, building it while we're flying. We don't even know what the jobs are of the future. And in fact, we were together just last month at the White House. It was the first time that NASA came together with the Space Council for the Futures Roundtable, and they invited millennials perspectives to come in and think about and talk about, well, what are some of the trends and what are some of the disruptors? A lot of what's going on in your conversations at the Juice Foundation with the Bridge Program, and I read about some of the solutions that the students are coming up with. And so we're having to even envision, well, what are even the jobs that it's going to take in order to drive these technologies? And so I think we're talking about opportunity, educational opportunity, but also economic mobility. And I want to give you a chance to talk about, we want to keep with this theme of adversity, and we can talk about your journey and your experience and how you've overcome that. And I know mentorship has played a role for both of you, so if you want to talk about a little bit of that. But then also, what are some of, you know, some of the groundbreaking innovations, maybe we start with Naya this time, some of the innovations and technologies that you're excited about that are emerging, that are helping to shape the future, a future that's unrecognizable to the world that we know today.
Mm. I am extremely space biased, so forgive me if I could continue bringing it up, but my research, which Zephanie so eloquently stated earlier, is in electric propulsion. And so if you're not familiar with that, you guys are used to chemical rockets probably. So what happens is there's a fuel and an oxidizer that mix. Boom, combustion, you have thrust, that's what gets you off the ground. Everybody familiar with that? We good on chemical propulsion? Good, okay. Electric propulsion is very, very different. You can't use it to get off the ground, actually. You can only use it in space. But the way that it works is you ionize a gas, so any chemistry buffs, anybody know what ionize means? Just yell it out. Charge it. Good, so you charge a gas, and so what? You have a charged gas, and you can manipulate those charged gases with electric fields. And so electric propulsion leverages electric fields to manipulate those charged particles and accelerate them out the back of a thruster or rocket. So it's an electric rocket. And that is the future of interstellar travel for us. It's cool, right?
Who's ready to go on a spacecation?
Spacecation. And it's becoming more and more ubiquitous in the field. Like commercial space is blowing up. I have multiple friends that have literally been to space. I'm jealous, but I'm excited because, I mean, it's showing how space is just not about, you know, our small bubble of scientists and engineers, and it's just opening up so many opportunities, jobs in various fields. And so to put it plainly, I'm most excited about electric propulsion because that is going to be the key to getting us even beyond Mars. And the further we go, the more that we learn, the more stuff and more information we can bring back to Earth. So it's not just about leaving Earth in the dust. It's about how the Apollo missions influenced so many medical innovations in the medical industry and et cetera. I just feel like there's so much to learn and to bring back on Earth. And so I know electric propulsion will be a very viable vehicle for that.
And Jaylen, just to bring you in on this conversation, maybe we reflect a little bit about how these advancements in STEM need to be equitably distributed, right, in marginalized communities, in Black communities. As part of that same activation, we left the White House and we attended the Afrofuturism exhibit at the National Museum of African American History and Culture. And the future is about equity. It's about making sure everybody has an opportunity to contribute and engage in the economy that's being created. And as Afro, you know, futurists, we're looking at technology as a vehicle to help drive that equity and to create these futures that are absolutely beautiful and brilliant and melanated. And I want to invite you, Jaylen, into this conversation. Maybe share what that's like in terms of your vision.
I think that's excellent. I think that's what my overall mission is to be, is like exposure. To be able to have, you know, people of color in the midst of these conversations is where the direction of the world I want to live in, should go. Like with my students, we talk about this past week with renewable energy, right? And who can tell me like some examples of like clean energy? Anybody can just yell it out. Geothermal, they're pulling energy from the ground and the earth's surface. And they're making a lot of industrialization jobs are being, you know, completed for the future in terms of pulling from clean energy sources, and they're installing, they hear all the commercials about they're installing solar panels, and there's gonna be so much job, there's gonna be so much job traffic in the next 10 years in that class of 2030 from clean energy sources, from moving in occupations that exist within around them, whether it's, you know, what you do, what you create, the engineering of it, making a battery, you know, your phone battery lasts 8 hours, you know, but you know, they're looking for maybe your phone battery to be able to last 24 hours, right? They got cars that are electric and sustainable now. And they use cobalt, which is mined in different places that have political issues around them. And there's a lot of imperialism. There's a lot of trafficking. There's a lot of violence that goes on. But if you can find a way to charge a battery without necessarily using cobalt and using other natural resources and being able to find out, there's a lot of different things that the world is moving in a sustainable approach. So being able to have people of color that are in the midst of it, that know this is coming and being a part of the engineering in the process, I think will be great. And on top of the equity part, you know, especially in a place like Boston, you talk about equity financially, you talk about equity in a bunch of different ways, but the one financially sticks out the most. And being able to have one, being able to have available jobs, being able to get into schools, being able to have social mobility is extremely important in that, right? You know, because if you can't even get into a school, how can you even be able to apply to a job that can even list some of these things that we're talking about? So fighting for, you know, equity financially is equally as important to be able to get opportunities. We talk about eliminating debt from college students. We're talking about being able to, you know, apply to get loans here in Boston, the housing issues that are going on here. There's so many issues that you can talk about in the tech, but financially, I think there's a lot of topics that we can bring up that we could do a lot better in.
What we need to understand is we're not talking about some reality that's over there. Right, we're talking about what's going on right now, and there's a fierce urgency of what we need to be doing, how we need to be thinking. We need to be comfortable with getting uncomfortable with the fact that, look, on the way here on the plane, I watched a series that was built, that was several years ago, but it was posited as being 40 years ago, and they were looking back on the year 2024, the year that Google crashes and that the Pacific went toxic. Now, Does that sound familiar for those of you who are watching the news about what's going on in the Atlantic Ocean and on the Red Sea right now, where they're literally boiling at the rate of hot tubs, a jacuzzi? So I need you all to understand that we're talking about what's going on right now. And as we kind of build on your visions for the future, I want to give you an opportunity in your closing to share, because we know if they could, there would be a long line who want to know, you know, give us some advice, you know. And we're talking about adversity, and we're talking about your journey. This has not been an easy journey for either of you. So bearing that in mind and our desire to thrive and be a part of these conversations, both locally and globally, share just a little bit of advice. And we're talking to two audiences here. We're talking to those who currently identify as wanting to participate in the STEM industries, and then those who are still going to be discovering how STEM and STEAM affect their day-to-day lives and the work that they're going to be doing into the future. So I'll give you an opportunity to just offer some closing thoughts that you'd like to share with them now.
Sure. I have two kind of major points. The first is persevere. You never know when your breakthrough is around the corner. And when you quit, you could be right there. You never know. I'll give you a quick example. I developed a stress tick being in grad school, which is officially a disability. I have a new disability I'm dealing with. And when I tell you that almost took me out, I was ready to quit. I was like, this is too much. It's affecting my physical health, and it's just too much. Was the answer to quit? Sometimes the answer may be to quit. If you're ever running up against obstacles that are truly debilitating, then of course, do that. But I had to make a decision to prioritize balance and to continue to keep going. Do you have a question? But you got a point to prove. No, because I'm not living for anybody else but me. but because I did own myself the ability to actualize the dreams that I wanted to do. And so that's why I continued to go. But did that mean I continued to run myself ragged? No. But it did mean I had to kind of change up my methods and introduce some balance into my life. And so persevere. Number two is to lean into who you are. We talked about engineering, we talked about all these different problems and solutions. These solutions are going to come from us, maybe y'all. I'm not that old, I'm 25. But it's going to be you all, pretty much. And it's those unique perspectives that make you so valuable. And when you try hard to conform and assimilate, to look and act and be like people you think should be scientists and engineers, you lose so much of that valuable edge that you have. And so just, you know, live in your authenticity. It's okay. If they don't like it, that's a personal problem. But that ingenuity that comes from your creativity, that are built off the back of your life experiences and what you've been through and what you've endured, that is what makes you you. That's what makes you valuable. So.
And I want to also give you an opportunity as Jaylen comes in to share if there are any specific programs or initiatives. I am a classroom teacher and a professor, so I like to give out homework. All right, so pull out your phones. Now, this is where you have permission to use your phones and take some notes here. Programs, initiatives, opportunities, what should they be having on their radar? Because I do have another homework assignment for you before we close this out in a couple of minutes. Anything that you want to share before we turn over to Jaylen?
Sure. Just part of Black and Astro, we've been talking about this White House National Space Council thing. So if you're interested in space, that's a very incredible organization to get plugged into. We have a lot of programming coming up this year, and you can be in astronomy, astrophysics, aerospace, space law, communications, space art. I mean, literally anything. We have a bunch of amateur astronomers, and it's just really a place for people who are Black people who are passionate about space to come together, learn, continue to grow. So,
all right. Jaylen, resilience, resources, message to the future.
Got you. I don't really. I mean, what was the? It was advice. What was it?
Yep, advice.
Instead of advice, I would like to issue a challenge. I just think, in what year is it, 2023? I think we have enough intelligence in the room, in the world. We got resources. We got understanding that we kind of seen a lot of where the pitfalls lie, right? And a lot of times, you know, for the last 20 years or 30 years or, you know, the history that predates us, we've watched, you know, our ancestors and the people before us fall to some of the same, you know, adversity that we continue to see over. The system hasn't changed. It hasn't really updated too much. They do the same stuff over and over again. And I challenge this generation to be the generation to be intelligent enough to maneuver around some of these barriers. And I know, you know, it's going to be some things that are debilitating, like you said before, but then I also think there's some things that, like, we shouldn't have the victim approach, that we could take the mindset of, like, man, like, all right, I seen that coming. All right, now watch this. You know, and I just want to challenge this generation that we are intelligent, we are strong, we're confident, we're bold. You know, we've learned throughout history, and then we have the opportunity to make history now in this generation. This could be the generation that could change everything for everybody. Right now, you see some of the things that were instilled through oppression 400 or 500 years ago, like the grip is loosening, right? You're starting to see people be able to make statements, to build things and create things that 500 years ago, of course, our people would have never been able to do. And I think, like, in this generation, this could be the one that could really make the difference. So I challenge everybody to do their part, but also be smart enough, intelligent enough, confident enough, bold enough to do so. Because a lot of times it's just the confidence that gets you to be able to get something accomplished. Everybody has fears, has doubts, has dilemmas, etc. But I just want to, from me to you, encourage you that, you know, you all are beautiful, you all are smart, you're intelligent, you're capable, and if we do it together, they can't stop us.
Amen. That's what I'm talking about.
Amen.
Now, for those of you who have your phones out, I want you to turn on the camera and turn it on selfie mode and look. And a matter of fact, I want you to create an artifact of the future by taking a selfie right now with your neighbor and knowing that this is exactly what we're talking about. We're urging you to grasp the power of STEAM. Use it to guide the visions that we've talked about. We've given you some ideas, some solutions, some opportunities. And so now we're asking you to go forth. We're going to see you online. We're going to see you on the front lines. And we just want to thank you in advance for the work that you're going to be doing. We're just getting started at the NAACP. The convention is kicking off tomorrow. If you're going to be here this week, I want you to go and look for me, look for the board members. And I'm going to issue a challenge. I'm going to be giving out a life membership. So the first person who goes around and meets elders, those of you who follow my story and follow my stories, you know, the song Better People talks about the power of working together across generations to drive the futures that we want to see. So that we can do what? So that we can fight for justice, so we can fight for equality, and so that we can ensure when we get to the moon and to Mars, that now we're not repeating the mistakes, the colonial travesties that we've done on this planet when we get there, because one way or another, we are going. And so I want to thank you both for your commitment to this work. I want to thank you. Look, we're always going back to church here. I want to thank you for what you've done. I want to thank you for your commitment. And I want to invite you to, again, just continue to contribute. The future is now. It's actually like yesterday. So we don't
Thanks have in advance. I like that.
It's so, and so let's do it. So there's supposed to be a QR code up on the screen. I wanted to invite your input. We're working on a cool project with NASA. Come find me and I'll have it later on the iPad if you'd like to type in and participate in some of that research. And as I said, that creation process starts right here, right now, with you. Because if not you, ask your neighbor, if not you,
then who?
Then who? And if not now,
then when?
Then when? So see you online, see you on the front lines. Thank you. God bless you. And see you at the top. To
Thank
infinity.
You.
And beyond.
And beyond. Give your neighbor a beyond. All right. Thank you.
That is.
I'm Time. Thank you so much.
Trying to tip your toe through the progress. Tongue tied when the truth is an object. What's the pros and the cons of this next check? Wasn't nobody round, I was independent. In the 97 bomb with the windows tinted. Heard a bomb, got a strap in the potty. Who the f*** laid this f- in the potty? Beat him up. Beat him up. Beat him up. Beat him up. I was seeing double in the projects. Mad at myself, learned to put it to the side. Mama had to cater for the coupe that we rode at the school on the way to pot pies. Wanna play both sides, just a red dot, don't get on the wrong red eye. It's a headshot, they became woo them guys. Round and buried two of them guys. I'm OD in Paris, I'm OD in France. I thought that I told you I need the advance. Put down your IG and look through my lens. A million to grandma, who did I offend? Miguel of your dreams, to me is a fan. I netted 10 million and did a little dance. I'm f***ing the world, I am in my pants. My uncle G told me that I had a chance. So then I popped out and did it again. And did it again, and did it again. I cannot respect them, where did he begin? Advice from the council, let nobody in. Been swearing through rumors, avoiding the trends. And dug in the holes, I'm dug in the loony that come with the shows. I'm grateful to man, he opened up doors. They bung on the tour bus to come and compose. I reach to the stars on my tippy toes. It's greatest success where most fold. I tell you my past, that don't get old. But how could you ask? Like I don't be riding my raft. The critics got everyone tapped, you gotta relax. The city where nobody sleeps, just tap in and ask where I'm at.
I just wanna rock. Body out of ya.
Damn.
This ain't what you want.
Project.
This ain't what you want. This ain't what you want. Ha! 1600 block. I just wanna rock. I just wanna. I just wanna rock. Body out of ya. Shorty got that body out of ya. Hit it once, no time. Side up. You gon' kill my vibe. Stand on my money, don't know my size. Pick them sides. And you better choose wisely. That's my high. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. That's my high.
Damn.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5.
MC, make another hit.
Whoa.
This ain't what you want.
Project.
This ain't what you want. This ain't what you want.
Damn!
Introducing back to the stage your NAACP Youth and College Division field organizer, Jamil Kalise.
All right. How y'all doing? Good. I need energy. We just had Jaylen Brown, Naya Butler, Craig, Stephanie Smith. Some energy. How y'all doing? All right. Yes. So we definitely got to see Jaylen Brown. I don't know if y'all noticed, since he's gone, I could tell y'all this story. I actually gave Jaylen Brown 30 in high school. Since he's gone, now we can talk about it now. But you know, we ain't gonna talk about that. But yes, that was a great, great panel. Hope y'all enjoyed that. But before we move to the next panel, I want to introduce our Region 4 National Youth Works Committee board member, Alexia Dukes.
We gon' be alright. We gon' be alright. We gon' be alright. We gon' be alright.
Hey y'all, hey! No, y'all can do better than that. Hey, y'all, hey!
Hey!
I was about to say, this is Friday, y'all. It's Friday. And we in Boston. It's something to be excited about. Okay. So, I got to get to my business because I only had like 2 or 3 minutes to speak. But we had an awesome and amazing panel of STEM people here today. And can we give them another round of applause? For the youth in college, it is imperative that we acknowledge and emphasize the profound importance of diversity, equity, and inclusion in a world of science, technology, engineering, and mathematics. The future of STEM is intrinsically tied to our ability to foster an inclusive environment that welcomes and empowers individuals from all walks of life. Diversity in STEM not only enriches our field with a wide range of perspectives, but also opens up the floodgates of creativity and innovation. When people from diverse backgrounds come together to tackle scientific challenges, we witness a dynamic interplay of ideas that leads to groundbreaking discoveries and solutions. Inclusion and equity are the cornerstones of nurturing such diversity, ensuring that everyone, regardless of their background, is provided with equal opportunity to contribute their unique talents to the field. By promoting diversity, equity, and inclusion in STEM, we can unlock untapped potential and unearth hidden talents. We must actively strive to break down barriers that have historically excluded underrepresented groups from participating fully in STEM. Creating an inclusive environment not only is morally right, but also crucial for scientific progress. By providing equal access to education, research, and opportunities and leadership roles, we can cultivate the next generation of diverse STEM leaders who will shape the future in our world. And together, we can thrive together. Thank you all.
Thank you. Thank you, Alexia. And just like she mentioned, I mean, there are so many opportunities in STEM that we need to take advantage of because we are underrepresented in that field. And so now we're going to pivot away from STEM, and we're going to get into those intimate barbershop salon type conversations I was telling you all about. So when I was younger, I remember going to the beauty supply store with my mama to get a little do-rag and my little waves, right? I know y'all know about that. And I used to see this product on the shelf. And I was like, what is this? This has got a picture of a black girl or an older black woman. Like, what is this product? And so that product was Dark and Lovely. Are you guys familiar with Dark and Lovely?
Yes.
Okay, come on. Somebody say yes.
Yes.
Okay. So Dark and Lovely has a panel prepared for you all today that is going to dive deep into what it means to build beautiful futures. And so with that being said, I'm going to bring our moderator for that panel to the stage, Miss Nicole Wade.
Thank you. How y'all doing today? I see you. Hello. It is a pleasure to be here at the NAACP conference today. This convention is amazing. It's, I believe it's day two. It's good to see all of our beautiful young black people here. Did anybody graduate from college or high school recently? Yes, that's what I want to hear, because we are excited for you. And this conversation is for you, because we want to talk about building beautiful futures. So building beautiful futures, this is our masterclass. And we're excited. Last year, Dark and Lovely celebrated 50 years, y'all. Y'all say 50 years? That's a long time. And we initiated Building Beautiful Futures Philanthropy. And this work is to tackle the opportunity gap for young black women, okay? So as we celebrate year two of Dark and Lovely's philanthropic initiative, Building Beautiful Futures, which aims to empower, support, and provide resources to young black women via robust mentoring experiences and networking, while also providing scholarships for students seeking undergraduate degrees, and most recently, providing funding and access to resources for black women entrepreneurship. Give it up. Yes, yes. So often the circumstances in which people are born, such as their race, ethnicity, zip code, and their socioeconomic status, it determines their opportunities in education and their careers. And we don't like that, okay? Unfortunately, this opportunity gap for young black women in the US versus their counterparts is still growing. And it's something that we want to eradicate. We want our young black girls to have the same opportunities as everyone else. Can I get an amen? Yes. All right, so that's why it was so important for Dark and Lovely to do something to address this big gap. Building Beautiful Futures has committed to providing $400,000 in scholarships with our world wonderful partners, NAACP and the College Girl Foundation. So we have one-on-one mentorships with our executives and mentorship masterclasses like this one with key executives and thought leaders. So our goal is to help to create paths of success for over 1,200 young black women and raise awareness around the opportunity gap and how we can collectively help to close it, okay? All right, so now this leads me to one of our amazing speakers, a nationally recognized financial aid expert. As founder of College Girl, president of the College Girl Foundation, author of How to Pay for College When You're Broke, and the children's book, College Girl's First College Tour. She educates students and families on how to make the best informed decisions around financing a college education. She has been featured on Good Morning America, The Tamron Hall Show, BET News, Fox Business Network, Essence Magazine, and several other outlets. Also, she has been a fantastic partner with Dark and Lovely. Please welcome Jessica Brown. All right, next up, y'all, we have a Gen Z activist, a social strategist, and graduate of Howard University, one of eight student leaders in hashtag Blackburn Takeover, the occupation protest at Howard University that lasted for 34 days, y'all. She has been seen on CNN, MSNBC, and NBC. Her activism has been recognized in features and coverage from national news resources such as the Politico, the Washington Post, and Rolling Stone. Hello? And she was honored in 2022 at the NAACP 53rd Annual Image Awards as Youth Activist of the Year. Please welcome Ms. Channing Hill. All right, now finally, we have the president of the Texas NAACP Youth and College Division.
She is also the reigning Miss Texas Black International Ambassador 2022 with a platform focusing on voting rights. The inception of Siobhan's involvement in the NAACP began as a freshman at Baylor University, where she became a member. As president of Baylor's NAACP chapter, she led the chapter to become NAACP's 2018 and 2019 National College Chapter of the Year. Upon learning about the leadership opportunities within the organization, she became an active participant of the Texas NAACP State Conference. After serving as the Youth State Treasurer in 2018, she was elected Youth State President in 2019. Her first effort as State President was supporting efforts towards Rodney Reed's stay of execution. And she is currently an MBA candidate at Johns Hopkins University and will specialize in public and private sector leadership. Y'all give it up for Siobhan Steuben. All right. Y'all, welcome my panel. Come on, give it up, give it up. Here we go, here we go. All right, ladies, y'all have a seat now. All right, so I can already feel that this conversation is going to be full of gems. So let's go ahead, and we encourage you to share your takeaways from the event. Mentoring means, and the importance of mentoring. So mentoring is when a mentor and a mentee, they make a commitment of accountability and growth to one another. Mentorship is important because it allows the mentee to develop, gain new perspectives, enhance skill development and communication, and transfer knowledge. Now, part of, I would say, mentorship for me, I would look at as I became an actress, moving into a very new field for me, and realizing that, you know, you just don't know what you don't know. So if you need to really like dig in with somebody who is seasoned and get really good background information, really good knowledge, and then some guidance on how to maneuver in things. So let us start with our very first question. Who has served as a mentor for you either in the past or currently? And how has that mentor helped shape your career? And how will you pay it forward? I know it's a lot.
It was a mouthful, that's okay. I would say one of my biggest mentors, I would say in the current moment, she's actually in NAACP, she's somewhere in this building. And so if y'all see her, make sure you wave, but she's also a national board member for the NAACP, her name is Erica Kane. And so she's mentored me so much. It's hard to see our relationship. It's very much like a, I won't say mother-daughter because she might hurt me, but we'll say sister, sister relationship where it's a lot of co-mentoring, which is something that I really appreciate, where we're looking at like, hey, she'll call me and say, hey, how do I do this thing on Google Drive? And I'll be like, hey, what does this thing in the bylaws actually mean? It's a lot of really great conversation, but then it's also not even just in the professional space, but also outside of that. And she'll be like, hey, Siobhan, you know that text message is a little spicy, right? Like, you know, had a little attitude in it. So, oh, okay, my bad. But then it's also saying like, hey, I think we could have done this a little better. So I really appreciate our mentor-mentee relationship where there are checks and balances. It is a lot about knowledge sharing, and it's not always about who's older in that mentoring relationship, but just who has the most knowledge to share in that respect.
Channing, what about you?
Well, I happen to have the privilege of sitting on this panel with my mentor, who so aptly reminded me as we were walking out that being NAACP chapter president at Howard, running to be Region 7 rep, all of these things Siobhan encouraged me to do. Anytime I considered or want something or dared to dream, Siobhan was always the first person I called, and she always helped me navigate, you know, where exactly, how exactly, and who exactly I needed to talk to. She has been my sounding board since I might have been 16, like when we first met. And today, you know, I can definitely say back then she kind of scared me. And now this is my big sister. Mm-hmm. And from my relationship with Siobhan, you know, I have my own mentees who call me sister and who are here in this building, who are working just as I worked, and who's continuing to take space, who I'm proud to see, you know, take space and follow in my footsteps as I followed in somebody else's.
Awesome. Jessica?
I would say one of my mentors is now a big sister of mine named Tanya Rapley. She is the founder of MyFab Finance. And I remember just starting out, I know you all don't know me, but for those of you who do, I am all over the place. I want to do everything at the same time. Like, no, I can be college girl. I can write 2 books. I can take kids on college tours. I can find a nonprofit. I can do this. I can do that. And she's like, wait a minute, sis. You know, you need to do one thing at a time, right? To let one thing grow and then move on to the next thing. So she's been my accountability partner in this. I feel as though no matter where you are in your career or your journey, everybody has to have a mentor to hold them accountable for their goals and their dreams and where they want to be. You know, I can hold myself accountable up to a certain point, but you always need that outsider that looks in, that can see your flaws, that can recognize your flaws, that's not scared to tell you in real time and in real life, in a real way, that you can understand how you can be great and how you can be better. And Tanya Rapley has served in that capacity for me.
That is awesome. Well, you know, Building Beautiful Futures theme this year is making bold moves. Okay, so I have to know, what does a bold move look like to you, Channing?
Probably taking over a school building for 34 days and not leaving. I definitely think making a bold move is a move that scares you, mm-hmm. That you're unsure about, but when you listen to your intuition, when you listen to who you are and what you know is right and wrong and what you know that you need to do, whether it's something everybody else in the room may agree or disagree with you on. You know, being bold is truly walking in your purpose despite all obstacles that we know they tell Black women, especially that we especially face in the world.
Awesome. Jessica?
A bold move is from being fired from Howard University after saving them millions of dollars in financial aid to now being able to sit on this stage as the financial aid for a godmother internationally.
Okay.
I remember going to Howard, and after Howard I graduated and I worked back in financial aid, and I remember one day they told, hey, today's your last day, and I remember walking out the back door. And I was like, man, what am I going to do? I can't call my mother to tell her that I'm unemployed again, you know. And I was like, you know what? I'm going to become college girl. I'm going to write a book, and I'm just going to take off. And everybody thought I was crazy. And then months later, I remember writing Dr. Frederick, asking him for my job back. Like, I really wanted to go back to Howard and continue to build beautiful futures.
Dr. Frederick.
And, you know, I just continued to keep working and keep my head above water. And after a year and a half, my book came out, How to Pay for College When You're Broke. Me and Dr. Frederick had to share the same stage with BET News about the Going to College special. Mm. And I think that, you know, sometimes when we're in a situation, you know, we're upset, we don't understand the why, but sometimes God removes you from something because you have a bigger purpose in this life. My purpose was bigger than being in a cubicle in Howard University in financial aid. My purpose was to help brilliant Black kids around the world understand how to pay for college. And it took time. You know, it was a lot of whys and how and not paying my bills and going to rent court to figure out how I was going to pay rent. But it led me to this panel here today. It led me to not just survive, yet thrive. And so I encourage you all may not see the lesson and the blessing, but I promise you in due time, you will see it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Well, come on now.
I'm just kidding.
No, I think a bold move is a lot about uncomfortability, about doing something that you know is going to be for your growth, but frightens you to the extreme. And so I remember even like college, I feel like was a bold move. So I'm a first generation college graduate, And I'm originally from San Francisco, and I now live in Texas, which you can imagine are vastly different places, especially given San Francisco. It's a very liberal place in comparison. And I committed to my university. I went to Baylor University without ever seeing it. Never stepped on campus a day in my life. And I remember walking on that campus. I went for a summer orientation. I couldn't even afford to do like our welcome week or whatever it was called, like a little boot camp before. And I remember just feeling so uncomfortable knowing that, like, hey, I'm going to this really rich school, like predominantly white school, that costs more than some people make in a year, and I've never seen it. And I have no idea what that means, and I'm going to be the only person from my family to graduate from this space, but also I'm going to be the only person here with me for the next 4 years. And so I remember also going and actually going to orientation and being lost. And then the first day, it took me 30 minutes to get back to my apartment, and it should have took five because I thought I knew where I was going. And I called my mom because I actually truly was uncomfortable and afraid that I wasn't going to make it back to my room because I said, I'm on this random street. The map is telling me, and I keep turning, and a lot of things. But to me, I think being bold is a lot about having to sit with the uncomfortability of not knowing what that outcome is going to be, but knowing that it's going to be for the betterment of you, and you're going to be successful in it because you're going to make it that way.
Yes. And those are some severely bold moves. And it's obvious that all of you are bosses in your own right. And bosses know they are known for making bold moves. So I definitely want the tea. Yeah, I'm starting. I'm going there. So describe a moment where you bossed up or made a bold move personally or professionally, Jessica.
Walking out that back door.
Not the front.
No, I didn't walk out the front. They walked me out the back. But back to that story, you know, that's when I made a bold move and I said, I'll never work for nobody else again. Nobody's going to be able to determine my destiny no more.
Yes.
I got tired of working in spaces where I'm the smartest one. I'm doing your work, but I'm not getting paid to do your work. I'm not getting the recognition to do your work. So you know what? I'm going to work for myself. And since 2015, I've been an entrepreneur. Now I'm an author. I'm a philanthropist. I've awarded over $100,000 in scholarships to brilliant Black kids. I do my own customized college tour. The list just goes on. So that's what I can definitely describe as like making bold moves and being fearless, because as I've realized on this journey, whom shall I fear? I'm my own competition in this world.
Yes.
When I look in the mirror to myself, I need to continue to dare to be different. I need to continue to never compromise who I am personally to get to where I want to be professionally. And those are things that I'm super proud of. And I'm just so happy to sit here with you all today and just talk about how the importance of us continuing to make bold moves, but not just us just making bold moves, but lifting other people behind us so that they can be in positions to also make bold moves in their life as well.
Absolutely. Yes, y'all give it up. Come on, Tim.
Okay, can I give you two?
You can give me two.
Okay, I can give you two. So I'll give you one first where it's related to this organization. And I think hopefully it doesn't, you know, touch a little too many nerves. But I remember this time 2 years ago, we were virtual at the time, unfortunately. But I decided to run for the National Board of Directors. And it was a little touchy because there was someone in the position who was already there who, you know, could continue. And I decided that I wanted to venture on that journey because that was the bold move that I felt I was being called, and I answered. And it was hard because, one, it was uncomfortable. It was like, okay, well, there is someone already there. And the Lord said, what does that mean? I said, oh, okay. I'm not trying to push anybody out. I don't want to do anything that would, you know, jeopardize anyone's relationships or anything like that. But it was a lot about pushing myself to say, what's the worst that could happen? And my mom taught me the worst somebody can do is tell you no. And I always add the worst thing I can do is ask again, which in a Black household, that probably isn't the best thing to do. But, and so that was something that I feel like I pursued, and it was a move that empowered me to remember, hey, I do have something to offer. Even if someone else has something to offer, it doesn't make anyone less or better qualified, but sometimes you have to make a bold move to make a statement of where you want to be. The second I would say is, as mentioned, I compete in pageants. And so that's something where I did for myself. Pageants is not something where I saw people that look like me. It wasn't something that was advertised in my family. It wasn't anything where I actually saw whether it was body shape, skin color, anything that resembled anything that looked like me. And I competed in a pageant in college. It didn't go so hot. I remember standing on the stage like, y'all didn't call my name. What's wrong with you? But I competed a couple years later, and so I competed in my first international pageant last year, and I placed first runner-up, and I was so shocked. There were all these women with years of training, and they competed in Miss USA and Miss America and all these spaces, and that's actually where I realized there was a cross between pageantry and advocacy. And I was like, oh, I want to do this because I see a space and an audience of people who are not being touched. I see people where we can be talking about voter registration and voter accessibility and healthcare and all these things. And so I'm actually in the process of making a really bold move right now and figuring out how to connect those two spaces and how to get conversations between different pageant systems where you have all these women who have platforms on these different topics about people that affect them. They're going into schools and they're reading books. Okay, that does something. But what can you do when we're actually starting talking about educational policy and we're talking about CRT and we're seeing things that are happening in states like Texas and Florida where we can be actually pushing more and you have these social platforms with millions of people who we can be impacting, where we're not asking the proper questions. So if there's a platform and an audience that can be impacted by the mission of organizations like the NAACP or people who are organizers and activists in organizations like the NAACP, I wanna be able to make sure those are impacted. So I would say the bold move was putting myself on a stage where people, you know, you gotta walk around and people look at you. But then also being bold enough to say, how can I transform this space to be even greater than what it already is?
Awesome. Chen, tell me about this bold movement.
I think, my take on bold moves is that they're our responsibility.
Yes.
As Black people, as Black women, it is our responsibility and really our charge to act boldly in every space that we're in, because if the alternative is making ourselves smaller, there's just not a society that we can exist in, our families and our people and our sisters can exist in without that. And the bold moves I also have too, but I think one that everybody in the room can relate to is taking a street and saying, whose street is it? Mm-hmm. Our street.
Yeah.
Whether it's in protest, whether it's on campus, or it is in our school districts, every time there is an injustice and a miscarriage, a loss of life, or somebody dares to determine that Black lives do not matter, it is a bold move and it's a dangerous move and it's a risky move to say, no, I dare to challenge you on that and I dare you to try me and try me again.
Yes, indeed.
So I think that's a bold move that I have grown very comfortable taking. And another one would be here, just in NAACP in general, and saying hello. I am a very nervous person in general, and making friends is not always easy. Mm-hmm. But saying hello to all of the faces of my peers and everybody that I end up making and building community with, those are bold moves because we are not always, you know, in the best position or, you know, not always trained to collate and coalition build. And that's a bold move. For all the introverts in the audience, it is a bold move to say hello, but also a bold move that should be taken.
Absolutely. So for all of y'all introverts out there, I need y'all to take that note. It's okay. Just go ahead and say hello. Somebody will speak to you. Somebody's going to give you a smile. You might actually brighten somebody's day, okay? All right. So now I want to ask, because this is the Dark and Lovely panel and we are building beautiful futures, I want to talk about hair.
Okay.
Whether it's your hair or your hair color. I know y'all see, I got a lot going on right now. So can you share a defining moment in your hair or hair color journey and what made you take that risk and make a bold move? Jenny.
Woo. Okay. So back in the day, a long time ago, I was applying for my first job. And I had an interview. And I was so excited because money meant my mama was, anytime somebody asked if I had McDonald's money, yes, I have it. I was so excited. And I was still learning what to do with my hair. So I put it in these two little braids. They were really Harriet Tubman braids, but you know, in her strength, I thrive. And my mom looks at my hair and she was like, you know, I was applying for a job to be a lifeguard for the city. We grew up in this predominantly white little city. And she was like, I'm not sure that's professional. And I was kind of stuck because it was just braids. I don't know what else you want me to do with it, ma'am.
And it's coming from your mama.
Right. I don't know what else you want me to do. And it was a very fearful moment, like walking in, you know, she was like, maybe you should straighten it. Maybe you should conform. Mm-hmm. And I didn't. I have a hard time doing things what I'm told to do. I didn't. And I walked into that room with my little Harriet Tubman braids. And I said, I know how to swim, so y'all should hire me. And I got the job. But ever since then, and it really, it became intentional, allowing my hair to take space. Mm-hmm. My hair is voluminous. My hair, people see it before they see my face oftentimes. And giving my hair the space to take space has been a journey in my own confidence, in my own power, and my own self-image.
Now, Jessica, I know you change around a lot, so go on, tell me. What's your boldest move?
I think for me, the hair has, it's the whole package, right? It's body image, how I feel about myself mentally, spiritually. There was a time I was a little thick joint, you know, and now I'm a little slim. But it's like, I think they all work together for me at a certain point. And once I started loving me, then I don't care about what my hair was like, right? Mm-hmm. My hair was just an addition to my personality. So for me, I had to discover coming back to love myself.
Yeah.
Finding those roots of loving myself and who I was becoming and who I want to be. And then letting my hair be an additional thing. And now I switch my wigs up all the time. I'm like Cardi B. I switch them up. I give them looks. I got a little short, little mullet, little wig with the sides cut. but it was hard for me at first establishing an identity, right? Because as a black woman, you're given a certain type of identity and my voice is already deep, right? So it's like, okay, I have to keep my hair light, you know, to kind of balance the two. But now I've accepted having a deep voice. I've accepted my body image. I've accepted who I am. And being on live news over 60 times around the world, you have to be very conscious of the image that you project, because in the first 15 seconds, somebody's already going to say if they're going to turn the TV off or not, mm-hmm. based off of your image. It's not whatever you have to say. So I'd always go for like the short bob with the little curl, you know. But now I just do it all because I love me and I love who I am. And at the end of the day, my hair doesn't define anything that's coming out of my mouth. It doesn't define my mind. It doesn't define what I went to school for. It doesn't define my accomplishments and my philanthropic work. So it's either you want to listen to me or you don't. But I'm going to show up as my best self unapologetically and love who I am. And, you know, that's just kind of how I let my hair reflect. Today it's braids with the edges missing on the side, but that's okay. Because I can get me a wig with some edges, so it all works out. So, you know, I think more so for me, it's just you coming back to the root of everything, which is yourself. And then once you really love yourself, your hair and your, it's going to be what it's going to be.
All right. All right. Siobhan, tell me about it.
Okay. So I want to preface by saying I grew up with a mother who was a cosmetologist. So my hair journey, she was very afraid. So I would say similar to Jessica, more recently, my hair journey has been literally like a journey of patience. So a year ago, I locked my hair. And so you can kind of see them right now, they're a little slick back. We got a little new growth. But I locked my hair, it's actually a year tomorrow. And it was right before a trip to Ghana with the NAACP, and I remember as soon, I was in the chair, she was comb coal in my hair, I was in the chair, and I was ordering a wig. And the lactation was like, what are you doing? I was like, I just in case this don't look the way I need to, I got a trip to go on. These pictures can't look crazy. And so I remember I wore the wig the next day. I got on the plane, I wore the wig, and I took it off the following day. And I didn't like it. I didn't like it at all. I didn't like what I looked like. It was similar to like a body image, a facial image. I was not excited. If you would have handed me a comb, I would have took it and ran it through my hair. And so it wasn't until we actually got to Ghana and there were all these people that were like, oh, you're so beautiful. Your hair is so beautiful. I was like, you're talking to me? Like, I literally felt like I was looking over my shoulder like, oh, is there somebody behind me? And it really made me realize, and why I went on the journey of patience was about being comfortable with myself, literally starting from my head down to my toe. And so even imagining, like, again, growing up with a mother who did my hair my whole life, when I went to college, she was, when I say fearful, so fearful. And I had a weave with leave in or leave out. Mm-hmm. It should have been left in, but it was leave out. And I had it for prom. I went to college. Keep in mind, again, I'm coming from San Francisco. No humidity.
Right.
Texas. All the humidity. And so I had, a weave with leave out. I flat ironed that thing 3 times a day. It was getting frizzy. I flat ironed it. Didn't know that is not what you're supposed to do. Mm-hmm. So I went to school in August. By the time I saw my mom in September, she goes, why can't I see your tracks? And where's your hair? Because I had burned it all off. Because I was trying so hard for it to look, wow. I mean, the way it needed to blend with the hair. But also the way that I thought I was supposed to look going into college. And then I remember having braids. And I had a braider in my family who charged $70, okay? Box braids, small. I was fine with that. Y'all now talking about $300, $400. I don't like that. So now we're on campus, and I'm talking to people who are not licensed, talking about $250. No, ma'am. So I had to figure it out myself. So I remember staying up to like 5 o'clock in the morning one day. I had work at 7, learning how to braid my own hair, learning how to do my own wigs, doing my own weaves. And so that was also transformational. So I would say my lock journey is probably the boldest move, but also college and going through that experimental phase of like, I'm not paying you this much, so we're gonna have to figure this out. And being bold enough to walk out, I think the first time I had purple, red, brown, black hair in my head, because that's just the hair that I had available in my closet, and we needed to figure out immediately. So just also being bold enough to walk out and say, hey, this is an experiment. I'm trying to figure this out. We're gonna get somewhere, but I'm just gonna figure it out myself, because as black women, we know our hair is gonna change all the time, and sometimes the funds don't match what we want to look like.
Understood.
Yeah. And I would say recently I started wearing my hair again and it's long. And I just want to thank Dark and Lovely Blowout Collection. If y'all don't have none of that, y'all need to go get that. Because that I think it's so important that we do embrace our real naturalness. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. You know, the wigs are cool, the braids are cool and all that other stuff, but we should be more like Shannon. You know, and really embrace our natural crown.
Yes.
You know what I'm saying? Because that is our crown, and we should really do more of being more of our authentic selves in this world.
Absolutely. And just to add on to that, that's a continuous work. Mm-hmm. Like, whether it's locks or curls, like the embracing the natural look, embracing the hair as it grows out your head is not something we're conditioned to doing. And I find myself even now on my journey, like where I can wear my natural curl pattern. It's low manipulation. When I'm putting my hair up, I'm slicking it back. I'm putting all types of gels and edge control on it to make it look tamed, as if it is not perfect the way it is, the way it grows out my hair. So I think a bold move that not just I'm being inspired to do, like being called to do right now, is learning what my natural hair, letting it breathe. It does not need to be slicked back every time. I can get that brush and that water, and y'all gonna see me and my edges unlaid out in the natural world, just like Susie does when she run out the bed with nothing but a brush. Right. So that's what that's gonna look like for me.
Yes, indeed. And as we talk about, you know, the acceptance of our own hair and wearing our own hair, we often change some of what we do because of going out into our professions. Mm-hmm. So when you think about that, what have you ever had any concerns? And I know, Channing, you touched on it briefly when you spoke about getting the pool job, mm-hmm. And going to be a lifeguard. But have you ever had any other time frames when you were concerned about what bold moves you were making with your hair and whether experimenting with color was one of them?
I'm looking for a job now. I'm a recent graduate from college, and I'm interviewing and I'm putting my foot out there. And every time an interview comes up, especially in like larger companies, I'm self-conscious. Mm-hmm. I'm wondering if I get on this Zoom link every time. You were just talking about TV. All of the activism or taking the opportunity to be an advocate on national television, I'm concerned. I have a mentor. She was at the last national convention, Demetria. You know, I watched her in Dallas growing up. Every time she wore her natural hair on television, they called her dirty. Mm. They said she looked like she smelled.
Wow.
So as I'm entering these spaces, I enter these spaces very conscious, very aware. My mother didn't have to tell me to be concerned about my hair back then for a lifeguard interview. And I think that's what we're talking about, a continuous journey of practicing and reminding myself, no, my hair doesn't define me, but my hair is part of me that I love, and either you're going to take it or leave it.
Period.
Because I deserve to be here. Mm-hmm. My hair deserves to be out, and it deserves to be seen, and it deserves to be loved. Mm-hmm. And it's going to take that space. And I'm going to continue to choose the bold move of allowing it to take that space.
That's right. That's right. Jessica, tell me about it.
Put my hair.
With that kind of you thought about, maybe I might not, I shouldn't do this because I got to go out in front of somebody and they might see me a certain way.
Well, I knew I couldn't wear that jerry curl I grew up with on TV, but I did go get me a red wig. But again, I was to the point where I loved myself. Mm-hmm. So I didn't care what the television said. You know, maybe what I did was probably pushed it back a little bit and put it in a bun, you know, even though it was still vibrant and a loud color, I still tried to tailor it. But I wasn't going to switch my wig up after I just paid for it just to do this interview, mm-hmm. you know. And I think before I was confident, that's what I used to do. Like, oh, my God, I just got this opportunity. Now I can't do this like this. I got to go back black, you know. And now I'm just like, what does that have to say about the knowledge and what's coming out of my mouth? Mm-hmm. That, you know, it's either you're going to take it or you're going to leave it. And if you leave it, you're missing gems. So I guess you're going to take it. So you're going to see me on TV. If I got red hair, probably a little red tint in the eyebrows too. But that was really when, again, it all came back to my self-love for myself. And as long as I love myself, the TV stations, they ain't never going to stop calling a college girl. Mm-hmm. And so once I got to that point and accepted that point, I just go up all as myself. So I don't really change no more for anybody.
All right. Cool. So Siobhan, we're talking about these locks that you have mm-hmm. going on, and I know we're going to discuss them now, even though they're not visual. Tell me.
Okay.
Would you dye?
Would I dye them?
Yeah.
Yeah, I actually, where is Zaria? Is Zaria over here? Zaria has some beautiful locks, and we were just talking about dyeing them. I've been trying to. I keep being told I'm not supposed to do that. We're going to do it anyway. She actually told me she was dark and lovely, too. I said, oh,
okay, send me a picture.
But I think as far as the question, I actually work in corporate America. So I'm a senior analyst at a company called Accenture. So I work in corporate consulting. Okay. And I remember someone asking me about my interview with them because it's a pretty well-known company, pretty rigorous in order to get into, especially like at my university, they kind of have like a little percentage they usually have. Mm-hmm. And so I remember other black women interviewing and being like, what are we doing to our hair? And I was like, oh, and I was kind of like Jessica at the time, I had some box braids. I was like, oh, we're going braids, whole thing, big ponytail. I have several piercings on my ears as well. I put them all in. I said, you're going to get every single piece of me. And so even as I've gone through, especially during the virtual time, I remember folks would be like, hey, like, we want everyone to turn their camera on. And I'd be in the bed with no wig on. I'd be like, we need a moment. And so I would be like, ooh, do I pull out the red wig, the purple one, the curly one? Which one are we grabbing? At a certain point, I was like, it doesn't matter. You're asking me to turn my camera on in my house. Like, what are you going to tell me? Go fix my hair? It is fixed. And so I think as I've kind of progressed where I was with in finding jobs in college, I was comfortable. And so it was like, hey, you are going to take me for who I am in this space with my hair. And at times it was kind of questionable during the pandemic of trying to figure out, like, what is that balance? Again, I'm in my house. Would I wear a red wig to work? I actually don't know. I don't ever go in the office and I don't plan to. but now even with my locks, I'm like, oh, there's no discomfort here at all. I actually appreciate the fact that I don't have to do much to my hair, even this ponytail, 2 minutes, great. So I really love our versatility of hair. I know there's a lot of states talking about the Crown Act. I know it just passed in Texas. I'm really excited. And so I think we have so much to explore when it comes to hair. And it should be a space where you should be able to do that at work, whether it's corporate America, whether it's nonprofit, whether it's any space that you work in, entrepreneurship, because my hair doesn't define what it is that I do, what it is that I bring to the space, what values I have, what characteristics or anything like that. If anything, I'm probably making your picture look better.
Hey. I just recently remembered, I made it to be a White House regional fellow. I didn't get to the last round, but I did do the 12 hours worth of interviews out of thousands of applications around the world. And this year I interviewed with a mohawk haircut and two cuts on the side and my tattoo showing up unapologetically. And I was only one out of black two people in the Northeast region that were chosen to interview for the White House Fellowship. Yeah. And at first, I remember when I got the email, I was like, ooh, maybe I should slip my, like, Make America Great Again wig on, right? And then my friends was like, no, you show up just like that.
Yes, indeed.
You know, because it's so important that you show up as your authentic self, even if it's for the White House, because even if you get the job, they're going to have to take you as you are.
That part.
And I think that that's the biggest thing about this whole conversation is taking us as we are, because that has nothing to do with who, our mind, our power, and like you said, our accomplishments.
I think it's not just, you know, take us as we are. I think a lot of things that we've touched on have to do with ourselves and our own self-image. Mm-hmm. But it goes back to responsibility for me. It goes back to mentorship. And if I look at my mentee, if I look at my little sister, if I look at the beautiful, you know, black girls who are coming up with bobbles in their head and artistic expression, you know, for so long, this conversation about our hair has been rooted in tiptoeing around white fragility, around white people's comfort with how we appear in the workplace. It's tiptoeing around, you know, I'm going to assimilate so you don't feel threatened by me. And if we're going into a world where the Crown Act is passed in every state, if we're going into a world that's truly, you know, about equity and not just equality, but diversity, equity, and inclusion, that looks like us taking the responsibility and the leadership and saying, I'm going to break barriers looking as I am so somebody can go farther than me being just as authentic to themselves. Yes, ma'am. Yeah.
Well, I mean, we can drop mic on that question because I think the one thing that has definitely been stated is the acceptance of oneself, making sure that you not only accept who you are, but you also accept how you were made, okay? Because each and every one of us was made uniquely. And there's a purpose for that. Amen. For every gift that you have, for every talent that you have, just for the look on your face, you were made this way. You were made to be exactly who you are. You must embrace who you are because that is what makes you who you are. You're different. And it's okay to be different. Some people, they're like, I want to be the same. I'm going to wear the same hair like everybody else. I'm going to do the same things. Mm-mm. Step out. Make a bold move. Be yourself. Be your true self. Every day, unapologetically, no holds barred. You tell them if somebody has a problem with it, you know what? You're getting whatever it is that I'm giving. Okay? And you're just going to have to accept it because that is who I am. And that's what I'm bringing you today. So I just want to say thank you for each and every one of these ladies up here. We have had definitely had a bunch of gems. that have been dropped today. I do want to say, as they are making bold moves, I want to make sure that we can follow you as you make these bold moves. So, Siobhan, how can we follow you?
Okay, my Instagram, only place you're going to find me, is CHKMATE underscore Queenmee. So it looks like checkmate Queenmee. You see?
Awesome. Jessica?
You can follow me at College Girl. It's GURLJB on Instagram. My foundation at College Girl Foundation, also on Instagram. Jessica Brown, LinkedIn, Facebook, College Girl. I hope to connect with all y'all in the future.
Awesome. Channing? So you can follow me on Instagram. You know, it's CHXN the world. So Chan the world, but with an X for the A.
Okay, okay.
Give it up, everybody. And if anybody is interested in following,
how can we follow you? Yeah.
All right. I am also on Instagram at I am Nicole D. Wade. And yeah, that's where you're going to find me. That's what I do. So as we're ending this, I want to end on a high note. Not that we are on a low note at all, because we have definitely elevated the environment of this room. And I hope each and every one of your spirits, as you move out and into the world, thinking about what it is that you bring. So we usually like to do some affirmations. And since making bold moves is our theme, I would like to start with, I will make bold moves by being my authentic self and bringing my genuine self into every room that I move into every day.
I love that. Okay. Okay, I will make bold moves, right?
Yes.
Okay. I will make bold moves by staying motivated and continuing to seek opportunities that frighten me.
Yes.
I will make bold moves by continuing to be a legend that will leave a legacy that will live on in the brilliant black minds of children forever.
Yes.
Okay, I need a second.
I will make bold moves by continuing forward, pushing forward, thriving forward, even when everybody tells me no, even when it's the unpopular opinion in the room. I will make bold moves by continuing on in my purpose, in my path. I will make bold moves by simply, you know, choosing to be bold, you know what I'm saying? Be black and I'm proud all the time.
Absolutely. Awesome. Well, again, I just want to thank each and every one of you for being here today. This has been an amazing session. I hope you all have enjoyed it. One thing, please remember to show up in this world bold, fearless, and daring. The world is awaiting the skills, gifts, and your talents. So a special thank you again to Ms. Siobhan. I'm sorry, I'm up here messing with my mic. Ms. Siobhan Steubing, Ms. Jessica Brown, and Ms. Channing Hill. Thank you all for joining us. It was a pleasure to have this discussion. Make sure that you follow at Dark and Lovely for more information about future events and masterclasses. Thank you so much. Thanks, ladies. All right. So I thank you all very much for being here. And there's just one last thing I want to do. Y'all had some little tickets. I want you to pull your tickets out because I want to get some gifts. We got a couple little gifts here. Everybody got a ticket? Just make sure everybody got one. All right. Who ain't got one? I said, no, I heard you. I know you can cover your mouth if you want to, but I heard you. First ticket is 144452. Nah, they must have left. All right, next. Ending in 7791. Now, I'll take it. Come on now. Ending in 4276. Not yet. Good gracious. 3786. Anybody? Can I get somebody? Come on now. Somebody up in here, we're gonna have to, am I gonna have to hand these things out? Oh, wait. Four, four, five, two. You said 3786 is you? Come on up here, baby. Demarius, that's gift for you. All right. Next, 4499. Going once. Going twice. 4398. My goodness, I want to dance. Y'all have been playing around. 3801. It was so close. Okay, we're going to get there. We're going to get there. 3801. Hey, come on up now. All right. Who's next? 3939. Come on, baby. I got a little something for you. All right, next up, 4524. No? 4524. Not yet? Okay, come on, we're gonna do it again. 4460. All right. All right, so I'm gonna change this up a little bit because we might be here all day. This gift is for you.
Oh, okay.
Thank you, love. Recently graduated from high school. Come on up. You can get another one. Now, I need, if you recently graduated from an HBCU, raise your hand. I said recently graduated. No? Raise your hand if you recently graduated from college. Right here, right here, and right there. Come on up here and get your gift. Y'all better celebrate these graduates. These are my graduates. I don't walk that many kilometers. Well, I mean, she done pointed you out now. Come on. I don't take for the gym, she no pizzas. And I got one more right here. Yep, you. When you come back, I give you digits. When's the last time somebody did it like this? All right. Now, I got one more thing I want to raffle off. Well, actually, I'm not going to raffle it off. Do I have any seniors in high school? Right here and right here. Come on up. Today we have how to pay for college when you're broke. Now, I don't know if you're broke or not, but I want you to be able to pay for college. So here you go. Y'all, thank you very much today. I so appreciate each and every one of you. Enjoy the rest of the convention. Yes, absolutely.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcoming back to the stage, your NAACP Youth and College Division Field Organizer, Jamil Calise. You know I hate it when I'm left on red.
y'all, what's going on? Oh my God, my God. All right, all right. We have made it. We are almost to the end. But please, please don't go anywhere because we have a dynamic. When I say dynamic, I mean dynamic final panel for you all. So I know we talked about STEM. We got an opportunity to hear from L'Oreal and some of your peers. But now we have an opportunity for you guys to hear from someone and folks who are doing their thing in media, television, what have you. And then we also have a dynamic moderator for you all. And so this piece and portion is going to be called our shop conversation. How many of y'all been to a barbershop? At least once. Come on, Miles. Come on, Miles. Thank you. And so you understand how precious a barbershop can be, the conversations that you can have in a barbershop, the things that you can learn from the elders in the barbershop, and the game that you can pick up. So much of what I've learned about myself, grooming, etiquette, how to treat people came from the conversations that I heard in the barbershop. And so I am so excited to be introducing our final moderator for the evening, Mr. Ryan Hardgraves.
Hey. All right. It's been a long day, guys, but I'm so glad to still see your faces here. I'm excited to lead this panel we're going to have about barbershop talk. As Jamil said, I'm a barber. That's what I do. That's what I've done for the last almost 20 years of my life. I was about your age when I started cutting hair, and I was 15 years old, first time I picked up a pair of clippers, and it changed my life. For the first time, I realized that I had control of how I saw myself, but not only by how I saw myself, but how the world saw me, right? And so what I want to share today is how a pair of clippers and the experience in a barbershop changed my life, and now it's affecting the lives of others. We'll talk about what I'm calling leading from the barbershop. We want to make sure that we help you all understand how you can effectively lead from the place you're in, whether it's from a barbershop, a classroom, a work-study job if you're in college or wherever you are. One of the things that we have to understand is that leadership is a very simple thing, although we've made it very complicated. Leadership, according to John Maxwell, is influence. Nothing more, nothing less. Now, the interesting thing about this word called influence is that in this world, influence has become something that is synonymous with social media. An influencer. How can I become an influencer? What can I do to get the followers and the likes? And unfortunately, what we've done now is we've traded influence for attention. If influence truly is leadership, leadership or any word that ends in the word ship should move you towards something, right? Ships don't just sit in docks. They eventually get on the water and move you forward, correct? Yeah? And so if leadership is influence, but influence isn't moving anybody, is it truly influence? No, it's attention. And unfortunately, what we've done now in our community, and especially our community and in our society, is that we've leveraged influence for attention and we've monetized people watching us, but we haven't moved them in a positive direction. So my real question is, what good is a platform such as a TikTok or Instagram or YouTube or any other media platforms that will come out if we aren't using them to help grow, mold, and shape people, not only their physical feature like I do in a barbershop, but their mind. The mind is the thing that made me fall in love with the barbershop. I realized that I had an opportunity that most people don't have. They get the opportunity to sit in my chair for 30, 45, sometimes an hour, depending on what the service is, and I get to influence their mind, not only their haircut. Are you truly using whatever space it is you have effectively and responsibly to leverage your influence or to grow your leadership? Now, my question is, as the people that you follow on social media, would you follow them in real life? Would you actually follow them? If they're the influencer that you like, if the person on TikTok is your favorite TikToker or the person on YouTube, you watch them every morning, would you actually follow them in real life? Or are you just getting some kicks and giggles every day so you can pass the time? I would have you begin to think about this idea. Leadership is based on these five levels. We call them the five levels of leadership. You have position, you have permission, okay? You have production, you have people development, and you have a pinnacle. Now, we'll talk about this a little bit more in detail in a second, but I want to put it in your ear. There are five levels to leadership. That means there's five levels to influence. And if you're only getting influence on one level from these people on your platform, are you really getting all that they told you they would provide? Or are you giving all that you told people you would provide? Maybe you have 10K followers. Maybe you have 100K subscribers. Maybe you have five people who listen to you in your group at school. Are you actively leading them in a way that allows them to develop in these five levels? Now, there's an old adage that says, anyone who's leading, if there's no one behind them, they're simply going for a walk. Are the people connected to you following you attentively? Are they following you regularly? And are they following you to lead them into a place, to develop them into a place that allows them to also cause other people to walk behind them as they walk? Now, this is an interesting thing because the thing that's really going to move it is another word that ends in ship. It's relationships. Now, the thing that I love most about working from the chair is that every week, and sometimes 2 weeks, I get to develop relationships with people. And as I said previously, ships move things forward, correct? Ships are one of the few vessels that we have in this world that allow us to move things from one coast to the other, from one country to the next, oftentimes without any intrepidation. They get across the water, things get where they need to go, and they flow smoothly. The relationship is no different. The more I relate to you and understand who you are, the better I'm able to help you get to where you're going. Now, that's my relationship with you. The bigger question is how is your relationship with yourself? Have you developed relationship with yourself? I can't move you if I can't move myself. The question was asked, hey, I have a job now. I have a position in my organization. I'm a leader now. And the guy who the question was being asked of, he said, what do I do next? He said, you lead yourself. Because if you can't lead yourself, you can't lead anyone else. How am I going to garner your respect, your attention, your buy-in to what it is I say the goal is? I can point to the board all day long, but if I have yet to figure out how to make it happen for myself, am I really someone you want to follow? You have to ask yourself these questions every single day. You have to ask yourself, am I being true to who I truly am? Now, social media will have you believe that you have to make yourself be something that you're not, that you have to follow the newest trend, use the trending music, that you have to dress like this or talk like that, your hair should look this way or that way. And large in part, it's good because we want to belong to communities. That's why we're here with the NAACP, because we want to be a part of communities that support the ship or the movement of the things that we like the most. But Shakespeare said it best. He said, "'Tis above all, to thy own self be true." What does this mean? William Shakespeare, some funny looking guy with a bad haircut, he understood that if you're not true to who you truly are, if you don't know who you are, when all the lights go off, when the phone dies, when the iPad has no more energy, when you can't make an upload, when the system crashes, if you don't know who you are you truly an effective leader? Or are you a carbon copy of somebody else? Now, my grandmother, she didn't have much education past going to beauty school. She too was a cosmetologist, a professional hairdresser. Beyond that, all she had was a Bible and some faith. And she said, son, there's enough people out here being themselves. You don't need to copy them too. You be yourself. Now, unfortunately, what happens is that we take these models of identities and we put them on ourselves. And then we look in the mirror and what do we see? We see an image of someone else. The biggest thing that we can do is make sure that when we look in the mirror, we see ourselves for who we truly are. That's where a thing like a DISC assessment comes into play. Now, aside from the barbershop, I'm also a life coach and a Christian counselor. And the DISC assessment is a tool that I use to make sure that people understand where they are. It's much like a map. When we do an assessment, we can look at the paperwork and we can say, oh, this is where I am right now in life. It's non-objective. There's no opinions in it. It's not about feelings. It's a hardcore fact about this is how you're portraying yourself to the world. So I don't have to look to social media. I don't have to look on TikTok. I don't have to look on Instagram. I don't have to look on any of these other sites. And I'm not saying that they're wrong. I'm not saying that they're not fun, because my wife will tell you, I love checking my feed. I check my feed every day, sometimes 2 or 3 times a day. But if I don't know where I am, it doesn't matter where they are, because I don't know how to get there. And a DISC assessment is a strong tool that we talk about in Good Life Coaching. That's my coaching business, by the way. That I give you this assessment and we look at where you are right now. What do you have going on? And we begin to have conversations that help us identify how can we figure out where we stand so we can figure out where it is that we're going. Because if you're not going anywhere, the laws of the world say that anything left to itself will self-destruct. That chaos is evident. It's coming and you can't stop it unless you start moving. So we start to figure out what are you, a D, a I, a S, or a C. We start to figure out, are you outgoing? Are you reserved? Are you task-oriented? Are you people-oriented? How do these things mix together? And what we do is we take those things, and especially for leaders like yourselves, and we blend them with these five levels of leadership. Now, position. Just because I'm on the stage alone, it gives me some position because you believe I know what I'm talking about because they put me on stage. But over the course of time, we develop relationships, and that gives me permission because now you trust me a little bit more. Now, what really happens, this is where the magic starts. When I start producing results that say, oh, Ryan really knows what he's talking about. Then we get to what I love. This is my favorite part. It's people development. Because once we begin to develop people, there's this term that I learned in church called a disciple cycle, which means I teach people what I've learned so they can do the thing that I do. And hopefully, if I do it well enough, they'll do the job better than me. Some people call this working yourself out of a job. And then eventually you'll get to the pinnacle, the fifth and final stage that says, when they hear my name, I become synonymous with greatness in whatever field it is. If it's barbering, if I become a social media influencer, if I'm a chef like my wife, or if you're a speaker like some people, like the people we've heard today, when they hear your name, they begin to say, I want to be like that. There was a commercial that once said, I want to be like Mike. Now, the people we're going to talk to today, there are these type of people. And if you want to connect with them, I want you to tap in and listen to this conversation so that we can also develop in the light of who they are. They're going to be examples for us today about what it looks like. Now, this is a barbershop talk. So it's not just about what I'm saying. It's about what everyone in the room is saying because everybody's voice is important. But if your voice needs to be heard some more, I want you to take the And when they come and sit down, I'm gonna introduce them individually. But I wanna know one thing. Are you ready to move? No, y'all sound like y'all still stuck in your chair. Are you ready to move? Yeah. Yes. Coming to the stage now, we have Mr. LaRon Hines, we have Mr. Brett Gray, and we have Mr. Kerry Wall.
Oh, y'all can hear me. Oh, okay.
All right.
They can hear me.
All right. Okay. There we go. Yeah. Now, I'm excited about this moment. Much of what I learned about being a young adult, by being a young man, I learned in conversations like this in the barbershop. And I learned it with great people like the people sitting to my right. Immediately to my right, I have Mr. LaRon Hines. Many of you know him for asking the famous question, are you smart? He hails from Mississippi, and LaRon is a singer, an actor, and a content creator. Who got it started at 10 years old?
Yep, 10.
We find out because you asked the question, but yes. You started off way before then.
Yeah.
Way before then.
A little bit.
Way before then. Now, from 10 years old to asking questions of social media, now Rolling Stones has now named you one of the most influential creators.
Woo! Yes.
Congratulations. Thank you. Immediately to his right, we have Mr. Brett Gray. He's an actor. Some of you recognize him. Many of you know the different platforms, some of them we won't name right now for other reasons, but we know him as an actor in his role on Netflix. Brett has played many roles and he started in school. That's amazing. I think that's big for us to hear that he started where he was. His humorous performances grabbed the attention of many people, including his teachers and his fellow students, but it all really capped off when his mother took him to a theater named New Freedom Theater,
yes,
in Philadelphia.
It was blackity black, black, black.
Blackity black, black, black. That's how I like it. Exactly. And then to his right, we have one of our very own, one of the NAACP's shining stars. We have Mr. Kerry Walls. Hey, give it up for Kerry.
Appreciate it.
Kerry is a graduate of Purdue, and he's currently working on his master's, a master's degree.
Yes, sir.
Come on, man. He's working on his master's degree right now in applied behavior analysis. Kerry is one of the shining stars of the NAACP, and I can't wait to get in this conversation with you guys. So my first question is, how do you identify who you truly are?
Mm. Mm.
We've talked about risk assessments and all these other things. What is the thing that says this identifies me the best? If you could put it in one or two words, how would you do it?
I can put it in three letters.
Go ahead.
G-O-D.
G-O-D.
Okay.
Come on. Yeah. Come on. Expound on that for me.
So for me personally, I grew up in the church. Right. Grew up Baptist. You know, all my Baptist folk out there, I don't know if y'all really get down like that. You know what I'm saying? But God is everything to me. You know what I'm saying? So before I go forth in any way, shape, or form, even my master's program, I had to go before the throne of grace, before I did anything, to figure out, is this for me? And then if this is for me, how do I operate in this space, God? So everything that I do, I get to give all the glory. You know,
how did you get introduced to this idea of God?
So I grew up in the church, like I said. It's just been all around me ever since. But wasn't really until freshman year of being at Purdue, really just going through like freshman year depression, everything like that. And I found the Holy Spirit for myself.
Wow.
And that's where I really just really started to captivate myself within the Word of God. And really, how does that captivate me and push me forward in my studies? So
if I heard you correctly, you just said that you had a mental health moment.
Absolutely.
And your faith helped bring you through it.
Woo. I kid you not.
Oh man, yeah. that's an amazing statement. So let me ask you, Britt. What's a simple way to say who is Britt? How do you identify yourself?
You know, I'm actually like a bit more of a mess than that. it changes for me all the time.
Yeah.
I feel like maybe the best way for me to describe it would be like just open-minded about it, because I try not to ascribe myself to one thing or to hold too tightly to different things, because you just never know where things are going to take you. And I don't want to limit myself in terms of like the possibilities of who I could be. But I also want to like ground myself in the things that I already know that I am.
Wow.
So it kind of like, it flusters for me.
Man.
So I just say like, it's a journey. I feel like every day, every year, every week, every month, every decade, something new is like, okay, I learned this time. I don't like this. I'm not doing that anymore. This can, you know, whatever, that can go. And then, you know what, I should try more things like this, or I should dive deeper into these aspects of myself that I haven't, you know, sort of charted a path through yet.
Wow. I heard you say a couple of big things. I heard you say that you're grounded, but you're flexible.
Totally.
And I also heard you say that I want to identify what I like and what I don't like.
Totally.
And I also have short-term and long-term goals.
Yes.
Wow.
Yes. Because sometimes it's like, I think I have like, you know, a flexible sort of like boundary or something. And then I learned this year, like, nope, not no more.
Nope,
if
not
I,
more.
It, you know, this thing is no, I'm not going to be able to tolerate this anymore in order for me to keep the peace in myself. So I just take it as it comes.
Man, I could sit there for a second, but I don't want to leave Laron out. Laron, how do you describe yourself to people? How do you say, this is who I am?
See, these are both very great answers, because I feel like as people, we're complex individuals.
Very
like, we can't really just put ourselves into one box of what we would describe ourselves. But if I were to add on, I would say my family is a great representation of, like, you know, who I am, because, like, you know, I'm a reflection of my family and how I was, my upbringing was raised, and how I was, like, you know, how I was brought up. So I feel like that is a big defining factor of who I am.
Man, yes. Family.
Yes.
Family. So community becomes important.
Very.
And the community that you know the best, because it was the one you were born into.
Of course. Yes.
Awesome question. Man, are those great responses? Were those great responses? Awesome. So let's ask this question, because Brett, you said something. You use the word boundaries. As men, we're talking about identity, we're talking about manhood and leadership. How have you set specific boundaries in your life, and how have they pushed you towards greatness? Because in your own right, each of you have achieved greatness. How are these boundaries and these standards pushing you towards greatness?
To be honest, bro, I'm really just learning how to, like, I've been like sort of a people pleaser for most of my life. I enjoy the joy of others. I take pride in like giving.
You're an actor.
You know,
still.
But yeah, like, it genuinely makes me feel good. So I had to learn how to like have more bandwidth in my life and just make sure that the things that I need taken care of are taken care of. The people around me are, you know, I can't set the expectation on them to give as much as me because I genuinely enjoy to, but to make sure that I'm getting some type of reciprocity in the relationship, whether it's friendship, family.
Reciprocity.
That's the word. That's the
word.
You
know the word.
Oh. He said, are you smart now?
Are you smart? I think you said yes.
Yeah. So yeah, like I'm really just now getting to a point where I'm learning how to actually really mean my boundaries. It used to bother me to say no. Wow. It used to bother me to like have somebody else have a negative sort of situation with me or just sort of outcome or you know, not to like sort of rise up to someone else's expectation of what I should be doing or, you know, how I should be doing it. So to me right now, I just like, have you ever heard of the book, The Subtle Art of Not Giving
yes.
a Fuck?
Yes.
Great. And she yes. talks about the bank.
Right.
You know, where it's like, okay, I have 100 fucks to give every week. And going to this party might cost 20. So if I get to the end of the week and you need me to help you move out of your apartment,
I have no more to give.
I have 3 fucks left and that's 50.
Wow.
You know, so yeah. it's like literally like implementing grace into your plan that's to real. Like, hey, I already have decided I don't give a fuck about this.
Wow.
You know, and whatever the person's response is to that just kind of has to be what it is, and I will show up for them in other ways when I have the bandwidth too. So that's I'm going through that process right now.
Man, so growth is a continual process.
Oh yeah,
it's not a one-time
event. And it
hurts
event, too. And it sometimes hurts. It goes against what you are used to. Sometimes, especially with your family too. Like you know, you set a boundary with a family member, and it's like I've known you since I was in the sandbox, and that boundary has never existed before. But guess what? Today
it does.
And wow. you have to accept me for how I'm growing. Wow. You know, even though you've known versions of me that I no longer, you know, subscribe to.
Man, so LaRon, we just heard yes. boundaries and family, and when we grow to these pinnacles of our lives, our relationships, they have to change.
Yes.
Especially when you work with the family that raised you.
Oh yeah.
Now
we've all watched.
Hey, who,
our amazing
niece, who we've all adopted. If you haven't adopted Jabril yet, something's wrong, right? Like we've adopted you into our family as well, but we watch you from a distance. How have things changed in your relationships as you've grown into a businessman, into an influencer? How have those things changed for you?
Man, really and truly, I feel like it's just a version of me stepping more into myself as a leader.
Right.
As opposed to being someone that's more willing to follow other people.
Right.
Because I say all the time, like, you know, as much as I have people around me that help me, I would much rather fail on my own terms knowing that I did what I thought was right as opposed to failing behind somebody else and doing what they thought was right and I thought it was wrong.
Come on.
So I feel like in this process, it has taught me how to be more of a leader and how to be more assertive in things that I want to do and my choices that I want to make, and not just with my career, but just in life in general. Like it's upped that for me a lot.
Man, so you saying that triggered a thought for me that I had as a kid, and it was this idea of being the man of the house.
Ooh.
Is this what I'm hearing from you now, LaRon? An attempt of you being like the man of the family, being one of the men who lead your family?
I would say yes, but say
that
I'm more
carefully.
So, yeah, because my dad's right there. Very but to answer that, I would say I'm being more of a man of myself.
Wow.
I'm able to lead myself more. Like I don't have to go to my parents, be like, hey, what should I do for this? What should I do for that? And like, of course I do go for advice when I truly feel like I need it. But at the same time, I want to be able to make those decisions within myself.
Yeah.
And I feel like that has given me more confidence to be able to do those things.
Man. So Dad is in the audience.
Yes.
Hey, Dad. and so in the presentation, we talked about what it looks like to model behavior to grow into our full development, right? Give me somebody, Carrie, who you've kind of modeled yourself after as you've grown in your development as a leader.
Unfortunately, she's no longer with us, but she was my former art teacher / music teacher.
Right.
She really pushed me to, one, be a leader within myself, but also just to lead. I sing in a choir. I'm a singer. So she pushed me to lead in that regard as well. And so she just really just helped me to figure out who I was when I was going through high school, middle school as well, just trying to figure out not only how do I define my voice, but how can I use my voice to help those who are around me. And though she was helping me from a singing aspect,
to me internally, I was like, okay, well, if I can captivate folks while I'm singing, imagine what I can do while I'm speaking or while I'm just out here trying to do just what I like to do, which, you know, now I do mental health and things like that. So going through what I went through, I use my story to help everybody else. So she just really helped me. Shout out to her, RIP to her, but she really helped me to define that for myself.
Wow. Wow. That's an amazing thing. It sounds like you said someone taught you how to use your influence to help others.
Yeah.
I think according to what we've talked about already, gang, that sounds like what? Leadership, right? That sounds like leadership. Can you two fellas give me one person or one event that shaped you as you develop as a leader? Now, I already got a feeling where you're going. I feel like you're going to go back to family. But Brett, I want to start with you because you play so many roles. How have you taken all of that and said, this is the event that has like really shaped who I am and how I'm developing as a leader?
Yeah, I feel like it's kind of hard to define yourself sometimes as an actor because they do know you for your role. And whichever one they like the best is whoever you are for the rest of your life. You know, so, you know, as you do a multitude of things, people start to dig deeper and say, okay, but who is Brett? I see you as this person and this person and this person, but who are you? For me, it's like, you know, a role is going to be always different parts of yourself, right? You can kind of compartmentalize yourself, you know, you can play a serial killer and never have been that. You right. know what I'm saying? But there are parts of ourselves that we may be able to imagine going places like that over, under certain specific, you know, circumstances and things. So for me, it's really been about like building it into my routine. Like, what do I do every day when I'm not on set?
Yeah.
Where do I go? Who do I hang around? And what is sort of like my purpose outside of making art and outside of sharing art? What is my purpose just as a person?
Yeah.
You know, how do I sort of like attach myself to something greater than a career or greater than an image or a character, any specific one character that was written for me?
Right.
You know, how do I attach myself to something like that? And what I really try to attach myself to is like joy. I try to make sure that people have a good time, that, you know, I can bring them some type of light and some type of joy. And I try to sneak it into every performance that I have so that people can say, okay, wait, I just saw him as four different people, but there's a through line here.
Yeah.
And that essence, you know, I feel like I try to sort of like inject that essence as me.
I believe you, because even in the back, everybody came in and they were happy to see you.
Yeah.
And so I don't think that's cap, bro.
Yeah.
I think you're really trying to bring joy everywhere you go, man.
Yeah.
I think you're doing a good job.
I am, man. Really, truly, like you said, I'm always going to go back to family. It's not really one specific instance. It's just like when I have conversations with my parents, since they're such a big part of my life, I tend to find myself like, you know, modeling how they, because like my parents, I consider them to be successful. I don't know if they, y'all consider yourself successful? Okay, I think they consider themselves successful.
I consider them successful.
I consider them successful.
Okay.
So I feel like I just kind of model from the way I see them operate and the way I see them, how I see them move and how I see them move through life and the way that they operate and run different things. I kind of try to model that in how I do in many things, not just with social media, but like, you know, when it comes to music, when it just comes to life in general, because I feel like that's just my best example, you know?
Man, that's awesome. I love what I'm hearing. Yeah, clap for that. Definitely clap for that. So as we close, I recognize a couple of themes in this conversation that we've had, even in this quick exchange of ideas, is that being tied to others and community is very important for each of us. I think we've all pointed out one particular person or group of people who shaped us as young men. But what I also recognize is that you're not tied to who they thought you were, but that you're trying to become something that you can be proud of. And for each and everyone here, I think that's the goal, is that not only do we know where we started and we take hold and we value the things that are being taught to us now, but that we move forward and we create an identity for ourselves that we can be proud of and one that allows us to step into the world and show ourselves in the best light possible.
Right.
Right? Everybody, I want you all to give a great hand to these gentlemen for helping us understand how we can move forward. Awesome. All right, and with that, we are wrapping up the Barbershop Talk series. I want to thank each and every one of you for joining us again. This has been Barbershop Talk, and I'm Ryan Hargraves.
All right. Thanks, you guys. That's how they go. I think I'm trying to get y'all pictures. Dang. Hold on, let me get in here too. If we're doing that, get in here, fellas. If we're doing that.
Oh my God.
Right. Hold up. Me? Oh. Can we put All right. Thank you guys so much. She said, thank y'all. Thank you all for sitting through this conversation. Get your pictures, your last minute pictures, please. Yes, please, and make your way back to your seats, please. Thank you. They'll be around all week. You'll get your opportunity. Thank you all. Hey, hold on, Brett, but listen. EP still go crazy, though. The EP go crazy, man. No, come on now. Thank you all for sitting through our speaker series. We are at the end of our Gen Z Culture Talk, and I am so grateful for you all for sticking around, staying engaged, and getting those notes. Did y'all get the notes? Okay. They dropped gem. Okay, for sure. New York in the house? Okay. I'm just making sure. But to wrap us up, I'm going to bring up our LeBron James. I know we had Jaylen Brown here, but I'm going to bring up our LeBron James, our national director, Mr. Wisdom Cole.
Hey. What's going on, y'all? How y'all doing? Y'all having a good time? Look. What I gotta say is, when Gen Z talks, America has to listen. The voices, the power, and the people who are in this room have been elevated. And I hope that you've taken away some nugget from this conversation. Y'all learned something today? Can somebody tell me what they learned today? Raise your hand. What'd you learn? Shout it out. Be your authentic self. What else we learned? Be bold. Leadership. We thrive better together. All these tools that we put in our tool belt to allow us not just to survive, but to truly thrive. And that's what this year's convention is all about. Ensuring that you have the tools to take back to your community to ensure that we have local victories that inform the national narratives. And so I'm so happy that all of you are here today. This is just the beginning of a journey this entire weekend. I don't know if y'all ready. Are y'all ready? Are y'all ready for the NAACP convention? Because this is just day one, okay? We got so much more in store. Tomorrow we have a phenomenal welcome session where we'll make sure you know the ins and outs of this convention. In addition, we also will have the VP there as well. And so I wanna make sure that people understand that there are gonna be some key rules for coming into that space. So make sure you're paying attention to your emails. Make sure that you are attentive to some of the information that's being pushed out. Raise your hand if you downloaded the NAACP convention app. I love to see it. Every hand should be up for the most up-to-date information about what's happening on the NAACP convention. Use that app, because we got an app for that. In addition, I want to make sure I see each and every one of you at tomorrow's welcome party. It's Y2K theme. Can we get it for Y2K? Y'all ready? We want to make sure that we come in, we celebrate, that we dance, that we are engaged in Black joy. Following that, Sunday is going to be our longest and busiest day. We're going to start with the sermon in the morning. We're going to get into our regional meetings. And then we have a phenomenal panel of young Black and elected officials, all under the age of 30, at our Roy Wilkins Luncheon. And so that's going to be a special treat for you all. And concluding that night, we're actually going to do our public mass meeting, which is all about Afrofuturism and thinking about Black to the future. We have some phenomenal people who are helping us reimagine what Black activism looks like today and ensuring that we have a path forward for the next 50 years. And so, again, there is so much in store. We're going to be actually back here on Monday night for our Juanita Jackson Mitchell Gala, and I hope each and every single one of you brought that fit so you can get that fit off. We got some cameras, we got some activations for you, and so we're just really excited that all of you could join us in Boston for this year's convention. And so when I say fired up, you say ready to go. Fired up! Fired up! Fired up! Thank y'all so much for coming. Give it up for yourselves. I feel like falling in love. I'm in the mood to roll something up.
Tonight I'm rolling something.
I need some drink in my cup. Hey, I'm in the mood to pour something up.
I wanna
go missing. I need a prescription. I wanna go higher. Can I sit on top of you? I wanna go where nobody's been.
Cuff it up.